Morning. Welcome to our City Commission meeting. We got Reverend Paul McCormick here from Trinity Lutheran to do the opening prayer.
Lord God, Heavenly Father, it's good to be able to call you our Father because of what Jesus did for us. Lord, I ask that you will bless this meeting today and that indeed your will would be done. That's always best for your people. I ask that you bless the city, bless our journey here, and continue to have an impact here as you always have. Bless each of these men and women with your wisdom and leadership, that they too would, out of compassion and mercy and foresight, make decisions that are in accordance with what will be best for the city. And this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Darlene, would you call the roll, please, ma'am?
Commissioner Cady?
Here.
Commissioner Brown?
Here.
Commissioner Rader?
Here.
Commissioner Nichols?
Here.
Mayor Brudnick?
Here. Gentlemen, we have the minutes of January 10th. Everyone had a chance to read those minutes and figure out if there was anything there that should have been there that's not there.
Yes,
and,
Mayor. I have read them very thoroughly. Okay. And I'd like to make a motion that we approve the minutes from the January 10th meeting.
Second motion, Mr. Mayor.
All right. Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes. Ms. Brown, is there any changes to the agenda or anything that we need to discuss before we get started?
Yes, sir. Mr. Mayor, if we could we pull item 10I this time until February 14th? There's some issues that we want to work through with DHA on some information and come back at that date.
Okay, and the City Hall?
Yes, sir.
All right. Motion to pull 10I. Do we need to do that?
Yes, staff is requesting it be pulled.
Okay.
Move that it be removed.
Okay.
I'll second that.
All right. Discussion. Call the roll.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
Excuse me.
Okay. We have consideration of a resolution protecting wildflowers. Do I hear a motion on resolution 1242017.1?
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make that
motion. All right.
Second.
Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes.
Commission has adopted resolution 1242017.1. Resolution of Panama City, Florida City Commission in support of conservation of roadside native wildflowers on state, county, and city roadways.
Very good. Okay, we have a notice for a Board of Adjustment on the, we have vacancy there, so anyone interested would contact Patrice and do so, I guess, within the next couple of weeks. This time we'll have audience participation. If there is something that is not on the agenda today that you'd like to bring forth before the commission, do so at this time. Come up and give your name and your address, and we'll hear what you have to say. Okay, seeing no one, we'll go on. Mr. Zimmerman?
This next item is consideration of potentially amending the Knox Box Ordinance. And there is no action to be taken today other than if you're interested in pursuing an amendment, it would be appropriate to give that direction. This came out of an ordinance that was adopted, I think, earlier this year. And the concept is to provide a box with a key on the outside of commercial structures that would enable the fire department to have access in the case of emergency. I received feedback, and I know some commissioners did too, of the concern that businesses ought to have the option, because if they have confidential records and other things inside the building, that they didn't mind the fire department coming in the case of a real emergency and breaking down the door, but to have a key made them uncomfortable. So there was discussion about that in lieu of providing a Knox box, that individuals could opt out of the ordinance if they executed a hold harmless agreement. And so a draft of such amendment has been provided. It was online, and it just simply says that businesses or properties that execute a hold harmless agreement that will indemnify and hold harmless the fire department of the city of Panama City and its officers and employees from any liability, loss, and costs, including but not limited to liability for property damage and reasonable attorney's fees arising or allegedly arising from the failure to have a Knox box. So if the door has to be broken in and there isn't a fire, well, they've agreed that they would not pursue the city for any damages. If you're interested in looking at that type of amendment and the draft hold harmless, then the appropriate thing would be to go ahead and schedule the first reading and then a second reading over the next two meetings.
Okay. Yes. I have a question, if it's okay to ask.
Sure.
If a business says, you know, that they don't want a Knox box, didn't we have a clause in there where they did not have to have one in the first place?
That's what this is for.
But this will solve that problem.
Yes.
Where they have the option
of not having one. Correct.
Okay. And then if there is a fire and they don't have one, and the city goes through the door, has to break the glass, you know, the door, there's a hold harmless agreement.
Yes.
Even if there isn't a fire.
Yeah. Whether there is or
well,
isn't.
Well, yeah. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Robbery or whatever. You know, or.
Well, no. You know, if we think that
emergency.
Yeah. Say right. They think that there's something. We get a call and we think there's something there, and we, in order to investigate it, you have to break the door in to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Then, because the problem that we have with the reason we got the Knox box is because we were having to wait.
Right.
Correct.
Correct.
And so, in this case, we don't have to wait. It fixes both those problems. Have you talked to this is the staff? You've talked to the folks that had concern. Will this satisfy them, I think?
Yes.
Okay.
I mean, the ones that talk to me, I've talked to.
Okay.
And it satisfies.
Okay. On a personal note, I would like to certainly pursue this.
Okay, yes.
Give people the option.
I like that. That's what I wanted all along.
They want to write a check, that's fine. I know in my business, I'm willing to assume that responsibility myself, so.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So the first reading at the next meeting?
Mm-hmm. All right. Motion to have the first reading at the next?
Yes. I will make that motion to have the first reading at the next meeting.
Second.
All right. Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes. Okay, we have a final reading of Ordinance 2599.1. Regarding the future land use map at 1150 Beck Avenue, designation as downtown district. This is a public hearing. Is there anyone here to address this issue with the commission? Okay, do I hear a motion?
Move approval of 2599.1.
Second.
Motion. Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick.
Yes, ma'am.
The commission has adopted Ordinance 2599.1, an ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect the land use designation of downtown district for one parcel of property located at 1150 Beck Avenue, Panama City, Florida, providing for repealer, providing for severability, and providing for an effective date.
Okay, next we have the final reading of Ordinance 2599.2, amending the zoning map of the city. Regarding St. Andrew Downtown District at 1150 Beck Avenue. This is a public hearing. If someone would like to address us on this issue, do so at this time. Seeing no one, do I hear a motion on 2599.2?
Move approval of ordinance number 2599.2.
Second motion, Mayor.
Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
Commission has adopted ordinance 2599.2, an ordinance zoning one parcel of property located at 1150 Beck Avenue, Panama City, Florida, having approximately 0.3 acres, St. Andrews Downtown District, providing for severability and providing for an effective date.
Okay, next we have a final reading on ordinance 2600. Providing a moratorium on medical cannabis. Do I hear a motion?
So moved, Mayor.
2600.
Second motion, Mayor.
Any discussion?
Public hearing.
This is a public hearing. Would anyone like to address us on this issue? Seeing no one. Do I hear, are we had a motion and second? All in favor? Sorry.
Hospital. So we're the PTO now, I guess.
It's not that easy.
We're Bay Medical now.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
Commission has adopted ordinance number 2600, an ordinance of the City of Panama City, Florida, establishing a temporary moratorium on growing, cultivating, processing, manufacturing, dispensing, distribution, and wholesale and retail sale of medical cannabis, low THC cannabis, and derivative products, or any related activities, establishing a temporary moratorium on the opening, relocation, or expansion of any medical marijuana dispensing facility within the City of Panama City, directing city staff to develop proposed land development regulations and other recommendations regarding such cannabis-related activities, providing for penalties, providing for severability, providing for codification, providing an effective date.
On the consent agenda, gentlemen, we have two items, 8A and 9, which are, does the commission wish to address either one of those issues separately? If not, would entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda.
I'd like to move approval of the consent agenda, Mayor.
Second motion, Mayor.
Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am. That wasn't me.
That wasn't mine, though. I'm on silent.
Okay, Mr. Brown?
Next is consideration of declaring a commercial shredder as surplus property. We have an unserviceable shredder in the police department that has since been replaced, and staff recommends listing it as surplus and removing from inventory.
Hear a motion?
Make the motion, Mayor.
Second.
Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
Next, we have consideration to award the purchase of one F-450 utility bed pickup truck with a 5,000-pound crane to Duval Ford in the amount of $75,041. This is for the utilities department. This is over budget. However, there are shortfalls in other budgeted items in the utilities budget and can make up the $5,041 shortfall. Staff recommends awarding the contract to Duval Ford in the amount of $75,041.
Okay, do I hear a motion?
I'll make the motion, Mayor.
And second?
Second.
Discussion?
Yes. Just want to know, Mr. Brown,
yes, sir.
And forgive me for asking, because everybody else would already know this answer probably. This runs on diesel, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Not on our natural gas?
No, sir.
Okay. Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnick?
Yes, ma'am.
Next, we have consideration of $126,535 fee for Dewberry Preble Ridge to design, permit, and assist the city with bidding and construction observation of the Snug Harbor Boat Ramp project as described in the attached proposal and approval of a budget amendment 1242017.2 to fund the same. Dewberry Preble Ridge was selected by the City Commission on November 8th as the top-ranked consulting team for the Snug Harbor Boat Ramp project, and staff was authorized to negotiate design fees for consideration. Staff has met with Dewberry to develop a proposed detailed scope of work and then negotiated fees for the work. The proposal was attached for your review. I've went over with the proposal with staff also and recommends approval of the $126,535 fee to Dewberry Preble Rich.
Okay, do I hear a motion to accept staff's recommendation?
Move approval.
Hear a second? Any discussion?
I think people need to realize, I want them to understand that this is a service we're providing, not only for the city, but for all of our entire county, you know, for this boat ramp, and it's a great facility when it's all done. You know, and it's a deep channel of water right there, too.
First class. Call roll.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brednick?
Yes, ma'am.
Next, we have consideration of conceptual master plan review of Bay City Point. Hawkins Point Partners, LLC, owner and applicant. The owner, Hawkins Point Partners, intends to develop the 35.43-acre site with commercial development. The proposed project will be considered in two phases. Phase one consists of 22.2 acres, which will consist of six outlots, a stormwater pond, a roadway, and five out parcels. The master developer, Hawkins Point Partners, will be responsible for developing outlot one, the stormwater and roadway tracks, and the associated infrastructure improvements. The remaining four outlots, two through five, will be developed by the respective owners or lessees. Phase two, which consists of 13.2 acres, will be built at a future date when all anchor tenant commitments have been secured. Upon approval of the conceptual plan, planning staff will review and approve the technical plans for each out parcel and issue development orders for each one. The proposed development meets the intent of the LDRs and comp plan. Staff recommends approval of the conceptual plan. The planning board first heard this item at its December 5th, 2016 meeting for informational purposes, and the general consensus was in support of the project. The item was then considered at its regularly scheduled meeting on January 9th, 2017. Staff recommends approval of the master conceptual plan request.
Questions?
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, I think it's a great opportunity to clean that corner up, and so I'm excited to see the developers moving forward with some plans.
You betcha. So, thank you, gentlemen.
Yeah. Are they here today?
I'm sure.
They are.
Hi, guys. I think I've only met
Absolutely.
You once. It's good to see you. Do we have any idea of knowing, and I'm sure this probably does not address that at this point, is there going to be a time frame of when phase two will start, or the city will ask for it to be started, or is that to be determined?
I guess it depends on how the process of phase one,
Okay.
Normally.
I think it's related to merchant recruitment and that sort of thing.
Okay.
How well that goes.
Sooner they fill it up, sooner they start.
You guys have anything positive you'd like to say this morning? I've heard some rumors. I think it'd be good for the public to hear. If you don't mind.
Good morning. My name is Bob Ledbetter. Got a little bit of cold, so excuse that. From Rome, Georgia. Your weather down here is awesome, so thank you for a great day. We appreciate you're working with your staff. Mike, we in particular, we are looking forward to getting started hopefully in March, with the probably in mid to end of March with the site work for phase one. We've got to get our plans finished and out to bid. And we'd like, we came to you guys earlier and you expressed our efforts as far as getting the whole project started in total. If not, we would begin it in phases. So we feel like that we've got enough interest to do that. So we're going to move forward with phase one, and taking care of a lot of the infrastructure, access, and things of that nature, and off-site and on-site. There's some issues with, flash floods on 77, and we're going to address a lot of those items, traffic signals and things of that nature.
Sure.
for access to the site. So we've got some exciting, you know, new tenants. We'll let them, generally they like to announce themselves,
okay.
So we'll let
okay.
them let them handle that.
That's fine.
And so hopefully, you know, you asked about phase two. Hopefully, you know, we'd like to be starting it today, and hopefully it'll come sooner than later. So
yeah, that's just not feasible. And we understand that.
Sure, and we appreciate it. So
I'm just hoping it's not 10 years. That's all.
I'm not either.
Yeah.
Well, on behalf of all of us here, and I'm sure the citizens of Panama City, thank you so much for investing in our city.
Yeah.
Appreciate it.
You know, it's a pleasure, and you should know that, you know, we get to work with other municipalities and other markets, and it's refreshing to, you know, to be welcome and to have the spirit of trying to get things done. And so thank you for your efforts. So we appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mike Lane, wherever you are. Did we vote already?
Do we need to vote on that?
No, you've not voted.
Okay. Do I hear a motion?
Yes, Mayor, I'd like to make a motion on that.
Conceptual master.
Second.
To accept the master.
Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Cady?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnicki?
Yes, ma'am. I did not give Nevin a chance to read the resolution for the budget amendment regarding the Dewberry Rebel Ridge. If you would do that at this time, please, sir.
The commission adopted resolution 1242017.2, a resolution providing for the amendment of the approved fiscal year 2016-17 budget for the city of Panama City, Florida for the Snug Harbor Boat Ramp Project.
Next, we have consideration of development agreement for 305 East Beach Drive. The owner, Massalina Holdings, intends to develop the 3-acre site with a 48-unit condo development. The units will be spread across 2 4-story buildings. There will be a marina with 25 wet slips associated with the condos. On March 22, 2016, the city approved a Level 3 development order for the property at the request of the owner. And up until now, the owner has never requested the city to issue the approved development order due to unfavorable conditions for the development of the property. The owner is now requesting this agreement that incorporates the previously approved development order for the property to provide additional time for the orderly and planned development for the property. The city's LDRs allow the city commission at its sole discretion to enter into development agreements with property owners, and development agreements do not replace other required development approval processes. Rather, they enable the city and developer to combine other required approvals into a single cohesive document. Section 163.3223 of Florida statute states that any local government may, by ordinance, establish procedures and requirements to consider and enter into development agreements with any person having a legal or equitable interest in real property located within its jurisdiction. To encourage redevelopment of the property located at 305 East Beach Drive, consistent with the plans of the city, Massalina Holdings LLC is desirous of agree upon and reducing to contractual terms the existing development rights of the owner with regard to the property. And staff recommends approval of the development agreement request. And I think this is the second one that we've done, if not the third.
Third.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Just brief explanation. Under the statute, the commissioners can have approved a development agreement. In the last 4 years, Sweet Bay was approved. Of course, that was a large project. It was a 30-year term. But then also the Buccaneer Lounge property was approved, I think, in 2014. That was a single parcel, a 10-year term. This is the first of 2 public hearings. Today's purpose is to take any comments. There's really it's not necessary to vote today. In 2 weeks would be the final hearing, and at that time the commission could vote to approve or not approve the development agreement. Letters were sent out to surrounding property owners, and a notice was run in the newspaper.
Okay. I have a quick question, Mr. Mayor, if I can.
Sure.
You know, when I was reading through the agreement, stuff that stood out was about heights and densities. It spoke specifically to that. But this also locks the other elements of our code, freezes it in essence, right? So if we were to pass something about certain types of plants, that would also be applicable, right?
Yes. Yes. Okay. This provides certainty for the developer that because he couldn't, they chose not to try to build during the term of the development order. It locks in those provisions that have already been approved by the commission in the development order for a longer period of time. But it also sets forth the understanding concerning the developer's obligation to rebuild the pump, the lift station at the time that the development commences.
Good. Saw a hand, so I know we're going to have some public comment. Did the commission want to respond after we have public comment, please? Is that okay? Any other?
That's fine.
Yeah, I'd like to have public comment.
Sure. All right, we'll have that for you. Sir, name and address. Come forward.
Jerry Lowler. My personal home address is 527 School Avenue, Springfield. As the president of the Cove Harbor Condominium Association, speaking on behalf of our 40 owners at 324 East Beach Drive, which is directly across from the 305. First off, and not necessarily in support of the issue before you right now, we are in total agreement and support of the project. We've reviewed the plans. I think I've communicated with both the mayor and Mr. Lane back in June. We have no concerns. We've reviewed the plans and everything else. They're fine. They add to the community. I think they're in support of all the stuff going on downtown and the city marina. Our main and only concern to the property owners there is the entry exit to the wet slip area is directly in the curve. And if you're familiar with that area, it's already a choke point. And there is little visibility as to the entry exit to the condominium ourselves. And we've had quite a few near misses and accidents and stuff like that. So either to the city or to the developer, we would ask that you take into consideration of some way of warning people, particularly coming from downtown over toward the Cove area, that there is an entry exit point. Now, to me, the slip exit in that curve is going to really add to the issues of the choke point, traffic over and across the drawbridge, which I mean would probably surmise is pretty expensive to maintain to start with. But I can't see them putting that entry anywhere else. The entry to the condominiums is over on the side street, poses no problem. I don't think it'll add to anybody's traffic. But we would simply ask that the city try to take into consideration what they might do to better mark or alleviate the issues we suspect we're going to encounter as we try to live, exit, and enter our homes.
Understand.
Thanks,
thank
Jerry.
You, Jerry.
I think
anyone else?
I think that's a good point, Jerry.
Good morning. Jim Sloaning, a Panhandle Engineering, on behalf of the permittee. As your city manager and attorney had mentioned, we're requesting a development agreement to essentially extend the development order entitlements for 10 years. There's several reasons. We talked about the economy. The owner just landed a multi-billion-dollar job, probably the biggest economic development impact in this county in the last 100 years. He has 40 Coast Guard people showing up today, so his mind is on other things than immediately trying to develop this. So somewhat of an extension would be very positive.
We want it to be.
We're also excited that we could be part of the marina energy. The second part, as noted, is this formalizes some of the terms and conditions of the developer constructing a new sanitary master lift station for the city. So I think those are the two big bullets in here. In regard to the condo association's comments, there are two existing driveway connections immediately in the vicinity of the proposed card reader access to the marina. We're using one of them. We're not creating a new one. We're closing the other. So as far as consideration, we're closing one and leaving one. So we're actually reducing the number of connections. And then number two, it's a card reader. Two or three, five cars on a weekday, seven, eight, 10 cars on a weekend would be the capacity. Lastly, it's on a convex curve. The curve goes like this. You've got great line of sight in both directions, and probably better line of sight than a 90-degree connection, which is the condo association. So actually, it's in a safe side of the street location, and we're reducing from 2 to 1, and only using the existing driveway. Anybody answer any questions if you have any?
I think, you know, as we get closer, some of the things that, that Mr. Lauer mentioned about signage and some things like that could go a long way. I know people fly through there, and even though it's a convex curve, I think we had somebody actually almost go off the bridge a couple weeks ago. So it's...
It's not everybody follows the traffic regulations on the bridge,
exactly,
I agree.
So.
But this will help slow them down.
It's an improvement over what's there now, for sure, from
no
drivers.
Doubt.
Thank
no
you.
Doubt.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. Anyone else?
Thank you,
okay,
Jim.
So I guess the...
In 2 weeks.
In 2 weeks.
Yeah, I can tell you I've heard from a lot of people all throughout the Cove, and I've heard nothing but support for it. I mean, this is exactly the type of thing that, that we've been asking for. So.
You betcha. Downtown. More residents living downtown. All right, we'll go on.
All right, next item is consideration of a... award bid for purchase of a 2017 F-250 pickup to Duval Ford in the amount of $34,559 utilizing the Florida Sheriff's Association contract. The purchase of an F-250 will replace a unit 400, a 2001 F-250 pickup truck outfitted for fire command unit. Has over 130,000 miles on the old unit. That unit will stay on board and be used by training staff. This new unit will go to the assistant fire chief, I believe it is. Staff recommends awarding the bid to the Duval Ford for $34,559, utilizing the Florida Sheriff's Association contract.
Motion to accept staff's recommendation.
Move approval to accept the item.
Second the motion.
Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Cady.
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brudnicki?
Yes, ma'am.
Next, we have a discussion of downtown parking. At the 2016 December 2016 meeting, the commission instructed staff to review the parking issue of the two-hour parking limit. Staff in 2016 had conducted a downtown business survey seeking input and guidance on whether to enforce the two-hour parking. The 52 businesses we were able to get survey responses back from, 26 were in favor of enforcing and 26 were opposed. Staff has identified actually four options. One is to leave basically as it is and just kind of leave do with status quo. One is to remove the two-hour parking signs. One is to hire a non-sworn parking officer. Staff estimates this would be an additional expense of approximately $40,000, probably somewhere between $35,000 and $40,000 annually. And the last is to establish a paid parking system along Harrison Avenue. This would involve approximately four kiosks being placed along Harrison Avenue. Also during this time, staff learned that many of the parking systems are app-based and can accommodate transactions by smartphone. Also during this review, staff discovered that the parking regulations section of our code needs to be rewritten and brought back to the City Commission at a later date. At this time, staff just needs direction on which route the City Commission would like for us to go.
Comments?
I think we need to be clear. What we're not trying to tell, we're not making a decision on parallel or angled parking. That's not what this
no.
is about.
No,
this is about people that are staying there over 2 hours and how we want to police that, correct?
This is,
I mean,
quite
let's,
honestly.
Let's be,
that's the crux.
Yeah, let's just, go ahead.
Mr. Rader, this is really about probably, I'll be quite honest, this is really about, I'm gonna guess, 3 to 4 businesses that have employees that park there all day.
And I've had calls on that, too. I think all of us probably have at times.
Yep.
We've talked to people.
And they're spread along Harrison Avenue, and
yep.
and their employees take all the parking spot, take up a in sections of Harrison Avenue, take up the parking spots along Harrison Avenue, and they're there all day long.
And I thought that's what Laverne was for. Am I being too blunt?
Go ahead. No,
that's all. I'm just a common sense guy.
I want to say it's about education, but I don't understand why we can't go sit down with these three or four businesses and say, listen, it's about why do your people have to be in the front of the building? I think it's hard enough to try to get people to come downtown right now. Now all of a sudden we're going to try to tell them they got to pay for parking. I mean, let's get a lot busier before they start paying for parking.
Well, and you know, the city has invested a lot of money in parking. I mean, we just purchased at least doubled, if not tripled, the parking downtown just in the most recent purchase.
Exactly.
Trustmark Bank. So, you know, we've been talking about strategies for getting people access to that parking and lighting and that sort of thing, and maybe some pass-throughs. But it seems defeatist to me that at the same time we're having that discussion, we've got people that are, you know, basically restricting the retail customers that want to come down and use downtown by parking in the street. I don't really know. Yeah, I'd like, you know, in a perfect world, people would sit down and talk to you, but we've got a lot of pushback, right, Jeff, in that regard?
Yeah, and I'll say this, and now I'm not going to ask anybody to come up and talk that doesn't want to talk, but I know that I've heard from several of the business owners that have went to the businesses that have employees that park along Harrison, and I think they've been politely told that thank you for your input, but we're going to park where we want to park.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
We're going to have to do, yeah.
So that's why I think they've come to us, because they've tried to be neighborly, and they're not getting any, you know, they're not getting that cooperation from.
Well, regardless, we have to do something about the laws that we've got on the books about this now, because some of the examples, if you read in there what it says you do to people for parking tickets, all has to be updated. You know, maybe that was written when there were stagecoaches, but it's pretty bad.
A $5 ticket or whatever.
Yeah, you know. I don't want to see anybody get hung at $5 because they didn't pay their parking ticket.
They parked their horse in the wrong place. Yeah.
So that all has to be addressed.
Correct.
And we do have to have some plan of education to straighten this out. Maybe take someone else to go sit down with these other businesses.
I mean, I know I don't want to put anybody on the spot either, but I know we have retail merchants that are in the audience, and I'm assuming they're here to talk about this issue. Does anybody want to say anything? Anybody? I mean, we can't offer you police protection, but...
We got to have some more.
You're saying that basically approximately three businesses. Let's be real here, right?
I can identify three.
30.
Yeah, and there might be some more. Has
any of the commissioners personally talked? I haven't talked to these three businesses. That's fair to ask.
No, but looks like I may have to.
Just walk in and say hi, you know?
But Jane, go ahead. We're going to hear from let's hear from the audience.
Oh, let's hear from Jane.
Jane Lindsay, 551 Harrison. This has been a problem probably, as you know, for a long time. And all of us really are at odds at what to do with it, and maybe... This is why we came to you for your expertise. I have a customer come and park at my store and comes in shopping at my store. They stay for a couple hours, and then they want to eat. They go outside and they see Tom's Hot Dogs, Maddie's La Casita. Can I walk down? Is it with walking distance to go to Willow's? Yes. So they go eat. Well, that's another hour passed. They come back and they say, you know, we didn't finish your second floor. We're going to shop some more. So here we are 5 hours later, and they're parking there still. What do? Do we give them a ticket and say, they won't come back? They get angry. And then one word turns into five people, and then the next thing we know, we have customers saying, well, so-and-so said I can't come down here and park anymore because you're giving tickets. Yes, there are businesses and a school across the street from us. The school pays about $1,000 for that parking lot that they have as a private parking lot across the street or next to them. They probably have more than 40 employees. Well, that parking lot only holds about 12 to 15 spaces because the whole one side next to the building is for the buses to come so they can let their students or their care out. So, Laverne. We all remember when we turned Laverne into a different direction because they were going to have to not be able to lease that parking lot. Well, that didn't ever happen.
We've changed that, though.
So that, yes, I understand that it's gone back. But that is a confusion again. But with those amount of employees, when you say, do we have Laverne? Well, first of all, I think we have at least three or four dumpsters in the back, which says where you can and can't park by the dumpsters. And then we have the other 30 employees, maybe, for that school that park behind on Laverne. We're at a loss as what to do. You know, if you provide these kiosks, like you've said, that might be an interesting thing because the city would have money. And then a person has a choice as to where they park. But once they come in and they have a ticket, no matter where they park, they'll still stay in the same place if they're paying X amount of money for X amount of time. So we don't know the answer. The Trustmart Bank that has been taken over by City Hall will be wonderful, but will that really provide the needs for all of the employees of the City Hall, which I don't know how many there are, and across the street in the back? And then we need to have signage for public parking. And it goes on and on. You know, as we see it, possibly a double or triple decker down behind the place, and maybe a double or triple decker behind City Hall. I believe you own the space that's on the across the street. It's an expense.
But Jane, that won't fix the fact that somebody that has a non-retail business, if they want to park in the street, because they show up at 7:30, 8 o'clock in the morning.
Yes.
So you can have a parking garage, and you can have all the parking spaces you want, but they're going to want to be within 10 feet of their office if they can.
And
so,
at Friday Fest, it is just swarming with people downtown, and they all find a place to park.
Yeah, I mean,
so we have a lot of parking.
But we have a different clientele on the event end of our city than we do on the day-to-day, you know, business. Because we have people who are handicapped. We have a lot of customers. Debbie and I have been in business for over 25 years here. Mm-hmm. And we have customers that used to pop into our store hopping and skipping, and now they're on walkers or in a, you know, carry hop around type equipment. And how do they get from location to location? I understand New York, but they're used to it. You know, and I think we can make do, but we just need to have some kind of resolution that would sort of help everybody. In the businesses, whoever was saying about the ones that are the three or four, we've had some come to us and say, we don't care. We'll just pay the ticket. It's only $10 anyway. You know, what's $10 for parking all day? Where can you park in New York for $10 all day? So, yes, we need a resolution. I don't have an answer for it. I have a lot of sides to that. I don't want my customers to go away. I understand.
I don't really, and I'm not a proponent for paid parking, don't get me wrong, you know. But this idea that somebody is going to be in Panama City and pay a dollar to park for 2 hours, and they're going to say, I'm never coming to shop at your shop again because it costs me.
A dollar isn't bad.
Or if it's $5. I mean, what I'm saying is that I just think that if you've ever been to any city that's even smaller than ours and you park in the downtown business district, it's a commodity that's in demand. So there's got to be some way of controlling that, you know. It just depends on what you want. I can't imagine in 1950 when there was a Sears down here that the only people that shopped at Sears or parked in the four spaces in front of Sears. Mm-hmm. There had to be many more people in those days, and they parked somewhere, and they walked. Maybe it's a different time. I don't know. But
well, we know what we're dealing with right now. All of us as business owners, all of us as restaurants, need help to make a decision, I guess. I don't know that we...
What's hard for us, and I can tell you, I think I can speak for some of these guys too, is that when this meeting is over with, my phone and email will be ringing off the hook with merchants to say, you need to do something about those folks. We need our parking spaces. Mm-hmm. And then here we are. We're trying to solve the problem. I don't know what to do.
I mean, can tell you that I honestly think that one thing that would help is better signage. I honestly think whatever we do,
signage
is very important.
They don't understand where free parking is.
Where the parking is at?
To direct people, parking behind. Parking behind for customers, maybe, or behind business.
We had talked about that with the CRA.
Or employee parking behind.
As far as having, You go to some cities and you see a podium type thing or a flat up where it says you are here and parking is available here, you know, or here.
And I think people are creatures of habit, and I think a lot of us, I'm one of them, we become spoiled. We don't want to walk a long ways,
yeah,
you know.
Go to New York and try to find a space.
And in the bigger cities, like even Nashville, you know, if you're playing at a nightclub, which I have friends that play music, they got to take their equipment in and then go pay $10 to park the car.
We did
and walk
with,
3 blocks back just
with the show,
to do
too.
A gig.
We put on a convention every year somewhere, and we did it out the Holiday Inn. And that's an issue out there, too. There's no parking next to their
It's an issue everywhere.
So we had to all carry. But we appreciate your
We've got to figure something out.
And listening to what we have to say, and I'm sorry I can't give the answer because I've had a lot of answers, and none of them seem to be the best one.
You could make every space downtown disabled, and they would still be full.
Oh, definitely.
Because there's so many disabled permits. What I have to do with my parents is I have to take them up to the door and drop them off,
exactly.
And then I go find
People
a place to park.
People don't realize you can be ticketed if you're driving a vehicle that is, and the person isn't there with you.
Right.
So anyway, we appreciate your...
So I guess the question that we have, and this brief survey kind of was split down the middle, is what's the will of the merchants and the business owners on Harrison Avenue? And I think we need to implement something along those lines that meets those needs.
Well, it's 26, you know, 26 don't want it, 26 don't. So I guess it has to be an education process to those three or four to say, hey, come on, let's.
There she is.
Thank
I was waiting.
Mr. Well, I'd already come talk to the last meeting.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Shannon Johnston with Hugh Salon, 231 Harrison Avenue. I feel like the two-hour parking should just be enforced because, like I said, I've already talked to you. We have a problem with the offices, and that's what it all boils down to, is them parking out there from 8 to 5, and I get a lot of complaints, and so does my husband at Relief.
Will that fix it?
I feel like we could at least try it, and if it doesn't work, then take another route. I mean, it's not like you're putting in meters and spending all this money. Yes, you'll have to hire someone, I guess, to enforce it, but... I talked to the Pensacola downtown, and they had the same issue, and they do the little chalk thing, and they said it worked for them, so I don't know. But that's, I believe Tallahassee does that too, or I talked to a few downtowns. But
we do have the foot patrol people downtown now, so I'm not in favor of hiring and paying, spend another $40,000 a year to enforce parking, and that's just kind of crazy to me.
I thought that they used to do that? The patrol that was already downtown? No?
I don't know. I mean, I don't remember, but, you know.
I mean, I've seen people in St. Andrews get tickets for not over time, but for parking in yellow curbs and stuff like that. So I know our officers do that.
Yeah.
Let me just go back on the two-hour parking, which from the history that I know and the signage that we have, I think back in the day, and it was probably 10 years ago, they didn't want to enforce parking, but they wanted to be just kind of, you know, awareness that, hey, here's a sign. We're going to make it look historical. We're going to put a sign up that says 2 hours parking as a courtesy. And I don't think it was ever, I don't think the signs are legal to enforce because it doesn't have all the disclaimers and you'll be ticketed and all that good stuff. So I think those signs would have to come out. You'd have to replace those with the legal signs that after 1 hour period of time, you will get ticketed. I think at the time that was just kind of a courtesy thing. Please park here for only 2 hours and move.
I remember them. Sorry.
And I think
Mike, have you got your
mic on? Is your mic
on?
Turned on?
Yep. Everybody can hear you.
Can you turn him up?
Okay. It's turned on.
You might need to move it closer to you.
Can you hear it?
Yep.
That's better. Yeah. Hold it up.
It's on. What I was saying was that I think in the period of time those signs were courtesy signs they put up, say, hey, please, you know, come here for 2 hours and move. So if we're going to enforce them, I think we're going to have to look at staff to come in and say, what's the legal signage to be up there? So if you're there for 2 hours or an hour or between 8 and 5, that you will be ticketed or fined for those. And that's what Pensacola has, and that's what Tallahassee has as well, because I've been over there and looked at their parking scenarios. So we'll have to change those signs out. And I think if we're going back and rewriting our parking codes, that all that comes about it. But prior to that, I think, and I don't know if Commissioner Katie or the mayor or both, visit those three individual businesses and just encourage the partnership, and because I know where they're located at, and they're right there in that restaurant row that they moved to the back, and I think all of them got back doors back there. So,
well, I would certainly agree to go at a different time.
Yeah.
Than you.
So I think that's probably, I think that could be the first thing, and then the second thing is get them to go ahead and do the code, look at it, and if bring it back up here for comments, and then if so, then we'll go ahead and put the legal signs up for enforcement.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, I'd like, and not any commitment, but I'd like to hear from the, what's y'all's feelings on that? I mean, in general, do you feel that the folks that don't have retail businesses should be parking behind a business? I mean, do we have a consensus at least from that standpoint? Or?
I think so.
Yeah. To me.
You
know,
I do.
I mean, you know, these guys pay taxes. There's a parking space right there. You know, it's there. We do have the signs as a courtesy thing. And as a partner for downtown, my thought would be, look, let's be partners. You know that you come at 8, you're going to leave at 5. Go park in the back.
So, I mean, at least you feel that they should park. Because, you know, I've gotten calls about St. Andrews, too. I mean, there's folks in St. Andrews that kind of have the same issue, some of the retail folks.
We have 12 parking spaces on Beck Avenue.
Well, I know. And that's so it makes it even worse when people that own businesses park in those parking spaces.
I can promise you, if you go to his funeral home, you know, for a visitation, when especially a big one, his employees will not be out front.
No.
They'll be in the back, you know, because that's reserved for the customers. You know, and it's not a retail business, but it's a people business.
But on the other hand, too, you've got some law firms downtown that their customers come up and they want to park, you know, and they may want to park right there and they go in. But to have the employees do that are there all day long is kind of nuts. So I think that maybe we can talk to them. In my mind.
I mean, what you're saying is you don't think the employees should be parking in front all day. That's what I think,
God
too.
God forbid, no.
That we should be able to sensibly sit down with these guys and say, look, come on. You're in a minority. We need help.
PJ?
Emmanuel Hill, local resident, 508 9th Street. My wife worked at the Willows at one time, and I used to sit out there occasionally. I don't know what government entity that is across from the Willows.
DEP.
They've got parking places in the back, designated parking spaces, but oftentimes when I was sitting out there, those vehicles, I don't know if they worked in that particular office, but they found it convenient to park out there and having that government plate on there,
in the front,
you know, allowed them to be there as long as they needed to be or wanted to be.
And that's what we're talking about, yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
I think someone mentioned something about the what I call meter maid. Now, I'm not sure. You can research and find out, but Panama City did have meter maids at one time.
Right.
A long time ago.
Yeah, we had parking meters.
Well, it was parking meters.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So.
And they were pennies.
When I saw this one in there about hiring that to come out, like going back to the old system of marking the tires or something like that. But I think we kind of going to dismiss that at this time. But right now, I think we are going in the right direction. We are discussing. We are having feedback. If we continue with this course, I think we shall come up with a logical, reasonable solution.
Yeah, we need to address the code, especially.
Yeah.
You know,
we need to work on the code at the front. And the other issue is that I know we talked about having the CRA officers do it.
Problem with having the CRA officers do it is we've been adjusting the CRA officers' time, and they're also not always downtown because those CRA officers float through the districts, so they're not always downtown. That's why looking at having a specialist or a non-sworn officer be specifically for downtown, that's why that officer would be downtown. But we've been mixing up their schedule because we're just working 8 to 5, and our homeless issue, we've been trying to address that through varying their schedule a little bit, and I think we've been seeing a little more success by doing that. and addressing that issue. So that's why we were looking at this other route. But we will we'll revamp our code, which includes upgrading the signs, which we knew that would have to be part of that process, and then coming back and then looking at enforcing a two-hour parking.
What's on the radar?
Okay. So I'd now really, we got direction. I'd like that's just what we needed.
And we've talked in the past about this, but I'd really like to see the DIB also look at this idea of a small sort of parking shuttle of some sort to these back lots. And we talked about that, and I think that really kind of falls within their wheelhouse or something that's very specific to the downtown improvement district that that they could look at doing, especially during peak times. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Anything to service the customer. Mm-hmm. Okay, we'll go on.
Next we have is settings the public workshops or commission workshops, excuse me, for the marina development. We've been having some meetings or actually some discussions with Mr. Sonnenblick. We will be having a meeting with Mr. Sonnenblick upcoming. Staff is recommending that we hold a commission workshop on February 21st at 6 p.m. And Mr. Sonnenblick has indicated that he will be in town on March 14th, and staff has recommended that we have a workshop at 4 p.m. with the commission also at that time. These will be public also. And staff recommends setting those workshops now at this time.
Okay, so we have to February, notice these.
February 21 is a Tuesday.
Yes, sir.
It's the third Tuesday of the month. And then we would have a 6 p.m. And then March 14th is a regular city commission meeting day. And you're proposing a 4 p.m.
Yes, sir.
Would it make sense to have the commission meeting following the workshop instead of coming twice?
No, I think we need to separate.
Just asking.
Yeah. Just I'd like asking. To separate it.
Separate. Yeah, Jeff, what do you plan on having? You know, we haven't, and a lot of it had to do with the holidays, I understand, but since the last submission. Mm-hmm. But, you know, when we got the September submission from Mr. Sonnenblick, you know, we had all had concerns, I believe, that what he had delivered at that point was essentially unchanged from what he had provided when we signed the negotiating agreement. And so, you know, we provided all this feedback to him and about the things we wanted to see change. I know that I met with him twice, I believe, in that period. And then we get this thing in the beginning of December, or middle of December, and again, it was essentially unchanged. And, you know, I mean, there were some minor things. I'm concerned that we're not converging on anything. And, you know, now we're coming up against a May deadline, and the agreement's going to expire. And, you know, what they delivered in December, and you and I have spoke about this, there just wasn't any detail in it. I don't think it met both the content and the detail requirement for the exclusive negotiating agreement. You know, we've been told repeatedly, don't worry about what I'm showing you because it's all flexible and it's all in flux. Well, they're running out of time. So,
now I think the conversation we've been having over the last couple of weeks, and I think this conversation we're going to have upcoming and the next upcoming to the 21st date, I think is going to be putting a lot more meat onto the bone. And I'll let Nevin pipe in if he needs to, and Doug, since he's here as well, if they want to. But I think there's going to be a lot more information. That's why I want to push to the 21st as opposed to trying to have something closer in. But I think we're getting much, I think we've had a lot better discussion over these last couple of weeks, and I think we'll have much better discussion in the next couple of weeks in fleshing out a lot of these details and getting to something that's...
Yeah, but I think it's premature, and what I want to see is more than just putting detail of what they've presented, because what's happened is that, you know, we talked about this last period about the idea of go no go things. Mm-hmm. You know, we're not going to, under no circumstances is X something that this community wants.
Right.
Continues to show up in these bubble plans. And the other thing is severability. You know, we explicitly requested, and we talked about this, that they come in and they say, listen, you can't sever these things from as a group. You know, this part of the project and this project have to go together. If you don't have one, then the other one doesn't work. And we didn't, there was never any of that. The other thing is detail about stuff like, you know, you can't just say we want the city to pay for infrastructure if we don't have any idea what the water usage is and the sewage usage and what the demands are. And they, at this point in the game, they should have sharpened their pencil enough and have that kind of that level of detail. So what is your feeling? I mean, you're generally talking to them. Do they have it and we're just not seeing it? Or are they just behind the curve on getting this stuff done? Or
no, I think the matter of fact, I think the issue on the go, no-go things, I think, has been addressed in our conversations. And they're moving the things that you've said are no-go. In our conversations with Mr. Sonneblick, they are gone. So those things are off the plans. And then you will see those in February that they are gone. I think once we, now that, so that takes some of that load off of the infrastructure improvements that need to be done. I think in the next probably 2 weeks, and then once we finalize all these uses, then we can address what those numbers are and finalize those numbers. In conversations with Matt, so far based upon what we've had, we know kind of where those numbers are at. Really, the biggest things that we've looked at is the hotel numbers.
Hotel demand, yeah.
Are going to be the biggest users. And so far what we've seen, what we had talked about back in 2005, 7, somewhere in there, whatever that project that we had looked at with that project back then of all the condos coming downtown, that project or that engineering study that we'd done, we can accommodate that easily.
Right.
So if we build to that standard, we will have, and not only, and the reason why we're using that study and those numbers is because if the marina develops, and then as we hope to have happen is the marina develops, then there's other off-site developments. What are those expectations of what we may see come on and expectations of other developments downtown? What do we think those will be? Will that engineering study still hold up? And will that proposed utility improvement still hold? And so far, I think we're still in that range.
Oh, about the no's and the goes and the no-goes. You know, we're having these public workshops so that the public can have some input on the goes and no-goes too.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
And that's the reason for doing it. It's not a formality. We want to hear what they want and what they don't want, and we want to make a decision to blend those things. Mm-hmm. So I guess it's hard to get. We do need a lot more detail. There's no doubt. And sure. You know, then we'll get into the numbers and say, yes, you know, this is feasible enough. And it is something that the majority of the public, we're not going to please everybody. Mm-hmm. But we're going to try to blend.
Yes.
Because, number one, we want to have enough local flavor in this project. But there has to be enough visitors to the project to pay for the developer's investment. So, you know, we have to be reasonable about all those different things. But the goes and no-goes are going to be determined. They're still up
there. I mean, one of the concerns that I had is that in this phase, and there has been a lot of public input. You know, we have a path where we've laid out these priorities. And a lot of what's been proposed at this point are inconsistent with those priorities. Certainly the order of those priorities about public space and open views and all those sorts of things. Okay, so a lot of that has been vetted to the public, and I think it's pretty clear what the will of the community is in that regard. But what I'm seeing is I see a situation where we get something and we say, okay, that's a no-go. You know, there's no way in hell we're going to have a 300-boat barn on the property. Right. Or there's no way in hell we're going to have somebody come in there and have a private yacht sale sales place on this property. And then what happens is the next version comes out and something else replaces it. So there's no convergence of the project. It's like every time we see an iteration, like this last go-around, there's a movie theater. I mean, they're proposing putting a movie theater on waterfront property, and it's crazy, you know. And so it's like now I've got to deal with that no-go again, and we should kind of be past that part at this point and kind of converging on some ideas. So
does everybody think that's totally crazy? I mean, I'm not sure about that. So.
But, well, the thing is, though, to have it put upon you at the latest version, I mean, what happens at the next version? Does the next version include all those things, or does it have something new? Does it have a horse track? And it's like, okay, now the horse track is ridiculous. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
And that's the complaint I'm hearing from the community is that we're not converging on something. We're kind of just dancing around. So let's converge. Let's get something done. Part of that agreement, I believe, was to have weekly meetings with Sonneblick, or at least biweekly meetings. You have to look, maybe Doug can answer that.
How often are you meeting with him?
I talk to him every week.
Yeah.
Okay.
And there's a reporting requirement in that agreement also. So I'd like to increase the frequency of that reporting. I'd like to have it weekly to the city commission in written form. But certainly biweekly would be acceptable. But I don't see the kind of progress, and I can't answer my constituents.
Gentlemen. Doug Sale, your CRA special counsel on this project. Mr. Zimmerman has been in constant contact with Mr. Sonneblick, as has Mr. Brown, and I have not been intimately involved over the last.
Can everybody hear Doug?
Can you hear me? Let me start over again. Douglas Sale, Harrison Sale McCoy, your special counsel on this project through the CRA. I have been kept abreast of the conversations between Mr. Zimmerman and Mr. Brown and Mr. Sonneblick, and to some extent have received some communications from Mr. Sonneblick, but I've not been as heavily involved in the project over the past 3 months as I was a year ago. So that gives me a slightly different perspective. I hear what you're saying, Mr. Kagi, and from my perspective, I can tell you that the discussions and negotiations with Mr. Sonneblick are not where I would have expected them to be at this point in time. Okay? That's a valid statement. But I would ask you to, one, think where this started and what our objectives were, what your objectives were, and two, what are the alternatives? Your initial objective was expressly to offer essentially a blank sheet of paper to the development community. And see what they thought would work here, and then make a decision. That's sort of a zero-sum proposition. You either like what they bring you, or you don't. I share your frustration that we don't know exactly what they plan to do, and that some elements of this keep popping up. The alternative is to wait out this agreement, you have no binding commitment, and start over again. I don't think that's a feasible alternative. I think there has been some give and take along the way, and in my mind at least, this meeting this week, I think, and you could help us a great deal as we go into this meeting. I think the purpose of this meeting needs to be to get serious about what it is you're really going to do, what your real numbers are, how much money do you expect from the cities to support, what's the feasibility, what's the gap of what the financial analysis, what do your pro formas look like, what are the forms of the lease look like that you want to have, what are the terms, where are your lawyers, where are your economists, okay? Let's see your team put together who's going to do this. Who are we talking to? One person. One man, and I don't mean to be dismissive of Mr. Sonneblick because he's got the resources. He's done this before. He knows more about it maybe than we do, which is another thing we need to be careful about, which is why we have Mr. Weiss. But the point is, when do we see your whole team that's going to make this whole thing happen?
Yeah.
Okay. And I would, for one, like the ability, and this is me, Nevin. This isn't Nevin. This is me jumping out ahead of this thing. But I would like you guys to send us down there saying, okay, tell us where you really are and what's really going to happen and be definitive.
I think that's a given. Well, I mean, that's...
But, Doug, we haven't gotten to that point simply because we haven't, at least this is the way I feel about it, is that we don't have any good information about what they really want to do aside from, you know, you don't have to be a rocket scientist or a lawyer to walk out on the T-Doc and ask the question, where are you going to put five restaurants?
Mr. Katie, all I can say to that is, going back to the original proposition, which was the blank sheet of paper, I'd like to hear what, let me be even more specific. This business of tying things together, if I do this, I've got to have this.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Been having those meetings.
I think that sounds very realistic from a developer's perspective. I mean, we're asking the private sector, you are asking the private sector, what's it going to take to go in your pocket and invest money in this marina?
On our property.
On your property that you will never own. It will be on a lease.
Right.
And they have one thing, one very, very bright note that's come up is he has clarified, Nevin, correct me if I'm wrong, but we had questions time and again. The only security that they will have for borrowing the money to build this development will be the lease itself. They'll have no permanent rights in the land. So, and they also understand, because we've explained it to them, that those leases will have performance and use standards in them, so that the individual leaseholds will conform to your expectations for what goes on down there. And if they don't, then if the lease evaporates once the remedies are exhausted, they have nothing. Now, if that's bankable, if they will go forward on that basis.
But Doug, you know, let me ask you this. This is, and maybe,
but that's what we need to
maybe,
hear.
Maybe you don't know the answer to this, but I too have, in the research we've done, I have confidence in Mr. Sonnenblick and his capability. Not so much in his partners and what they, but certainly in this particular thing, but certainly in him and what he can do. But he came up with those numbers somewhere. You know, when he delivered the document in December and he said, you know, I'm going to pay you $75,000 a year on parcel two, there's some basis, and that risk should be, and I know it's a starting point for him and it's not binding or anything, but there's some reason he said 75 years, $75,000 a year, and a, you know, this much revenue sharing. There's some basis of that. And I'm surprised that we don't know those things.
I would like to be further along, too, but all I'm asking you to do is to not be dismissive of the notion that my principal ask of you is to not be dismissive of the notion that Mr. Sonnenblick comes in and says, if I'm going to do this, I'm going to need this piece, and this piece tied together.
Right, that's what I want to hear, yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Because that seems to me to be very reasonable.
I just want to get into the details.
Yes. Okay. That's the purpose.
And I can tell you, you know, my conversations with him, and I think you guys have had the same experience, he has said as much. He said, you know, if I've expressed concern about some aspect of the project, he'll say, well, we don't have to have that. We can take that off. And he'll ask you to physically scratch it off the document, the drawing, and then it appears on the next one. But the point being, he somehow knows that. You know, if we decide as a city commission, as a city, that we don't want this marina developer to do anything south of the T-Dock, for instance, and that I need to know from Mr. Sonnenblick whether the hotel model and the convention center model or the civic center model that he's built is sufficient to support the project north of the T-Dock? Or do I have to give up the marina in order to make this deal work? Or do I have to give up the T-Dock in order to make this work? And what I expected to see at this point is I understand the blank slate because you and I had worked early on in that, and it was a key part of trying to understand what was possible, but we're not converging on that. I would expect as the months progress that we all get smarter, including the developer, and they would have fine-tuned those things. And we're still blank slating it.
We I think, will certainly convey.
Well, I think that's where we're, and I think that the conversation this week, and I think that's where we're headed towards, Commissioner.
Okay. Do you need anything from, you know, we submitted, I think we all submitted something in September to the developer and said, hey, listen, we looked at the first thing you did. This is what we like and don't like. Do you need anything from us now or do you feel confident you have enough information about how we feel? Do we need to write something else to y'all?
If there's something else you want to give me, we could take
something
it.
Something new?
Definitely. I mean, if there's anything
new, it hasn't really changed.
No. Okay.
I think your frustration about seeing some of the stuff that was on the previous things, we've already had conversations with Mr. Sonnenblick, and I think boat sales was one of them. We've already have had that conversation with him, and I think I can safely say that has been removed.
We talked about, residential rental, a lot of different things.
We have told him that's okay. Off the residential part. I think can safely say that's been taken off.
I'm just listening here, just kind of connect the dots for everybody in the audience as well. So prior to the 21st, you'll provide us something to see based on all the input we've given over the period of time that they're following that direction. And you guys are on the right track in that part. From that, we'll have our first meeting with the public to lay out the plans of what the developer thinks he could do on the arena project. We'll take community input. If we need to make changes at that point, we'll make those changes as well. And then we come back on the 14th with that, hopefully that final plan with the community input on the 14th as well.
Yeah.
And again, is I think what we did, we said back at, I can't remember what month, is that let's put Nevin and Jeff and let them be the negotiation power to work through all the financial aspects, the planning, to get it to a part to be able to brought back to us. And I agree with you. I'm kind of like, there's things that that I think we all agree on that we did not want the marina, and we didn't give a blank canvas. We did have specific items that we wanted, such as the open space and be able to use the marina, be able to fish on the thing. That was standard. We're not leaving those. We're not deserting those. Those are still there. So it's not truly a blank slate. So I think we'll see something. Well, we have to see something prior to the 21st, and then on the 21st, we'll get everybody in the community. We'll advertise it and bring the whole community. If this space is not big enough, we'll go across the street or somewhere to accommodate everybody, and then show those plans. And we'll take as much time as we need to listen input, and they need to know, because is maybe as confused as we are a little bit. We need to get a little bit more information on exactly, and again, for him to be able to say, hey, feasibly, I could do this.
As a somewhat outsider in the recent conversations that y'all have had with your staff, with Mr. Zimmer and Mr. Brown, I guess your question, Mr. Cady, might be, Jeff, Nevin, do you feel like you're clear enough in your minds of what we want and don't want that you can make it clear to Mr. Sonnenblick? And I think when Mr. Zimmerman and Mr. Brown tell Mr. Sonnenblick something, I think he'll believe it, and there's always a telephone to call one or two of you up if there's something new comes up.
I want to interject one. Well, go ahead.
One thing I just wanted to address, and Commissioner Cady had said, where did the $75,000 come from? And I can explain where it came from, but it relates back to a philosophy that I think the commission had, and I just want to reiterate that. And the basic philosophy is that in the early years of the project, the commission isn't looking for revenue. They're looking to encourage investment into the marina. And that the only new money or new revenues would be spent to support it, and then over time, then the city would be receiving revenue. So when the parking garage was discussed, Mr. Sonnenblick had an estimate of $32 million if he built both parking garages, and I know that's still, that's still an issue to look at, whether both are needed. But if that was done, then he would either need, and he paid for it, he would either need to charge a parking fee, which he really didn't want to do, or the parking could be free to the public, and the debt service would be $500,000 a year for a $32 million worth of parking garages. So his proposal was, look, I'd really rather it be free, but I'll tell you what, I will pay ground rent of $500,000 a year. The city can take that revenue and then use it toward payment on the parking garage. that was...
Yeah, without getting into the details, but I thought in the latest submittal, that was separate, and he talked about that option about whether we wanted to have paid parking or, and he said in the event that you don't and you make it free, then you would need, there would need some city support for that. It was kind of divorced from the issue, I thought, of the, you know, the numbers are in the noise. When you're talking about hundreds of million dollars of development, $500,000 in rent, and that's really not an important issue. You know, I think it's more, some of the issues that are more important is the terms of the lease and some other thing. And I understand it's a starting position.
I think that, yes, Mr. Nichols, it was not a completely blank slate. I overstated that, but we were, within those broad parameters, you were looking for what the private sector would do. I think that the Mr. Sonnenbleck and his other partner have brought some ideas that were outside of that original scope, and y'all have dealt with that. I think that going forward, and you touched on it, and I think it might be useful to keep this in mind, the pinch points in our discussions and negotiations, your discussions and negotiations with this developer, and you've asked him to take a position first, but I think the pinch points are going to be balancing the local amenity of that marina, the public access, open space, the public's amenity, balancing that with enough development to ignite downtown. That's one. And he understands that. Absolutely. Number two is what you touched on. The pinch point is going to be the use covenants, affirmative and negative covenants in these leases. What you must do affirmatively, what you cannot do negatively. The detail in those, that's a pinch point where it could fall apart. But we need to get to that, and he's got to give us his first cut at the leases because, again, we asked them to speak to us. And then the question of feasibility, will it work? What's your confidence level? That's another pinch point, and that's why you have not me, I've never, but you have someone like Mr. Beisch, who is an independent consultant and does this all around the country all the time, to look at his numbers, look at their, you say you want to see his numbers, you want to see his analysis, to not redo the analysis, but to look at it and see if it appears to be reasonable, which is what Mr. Beisch has done before in other projects that I've been involved in. So I think those are the pinch points you're looking as it goes forward. First and foremost, balancing the community asset, the community amenity aspect of this marina with the desire to leverage the marina into igniting more development downtown.
The catalyst.
Secondly, how tight can you restrict these leases and still be bankable? How tight can these covenants be? It's got to be a certain class of hotel with a bank lend on that. Without the ability to convert that hotel, downscale it? We don't know. We've got to get into that. And then third, the feasibility of it all. So with that...
You know, and Doug, real quick, and I appreciate it. My concern, too, is, and this is more of a political, public relations concern, is
absolutely.
That I haven't personally felt that I've gotten the level of response to kind of the comments that I've made. If we have two public meetings, which we will, and the public makes those comments, and everybody says we hear you, and then they come out with a plan and it looks as essentially unchanged, the frustration that I feel right now, we're going to have a revolution in this city, okay? I mean, we've got to make progress. We can't continually be told that we hear you and we continually see is the same thing.
That's going to be the initial public concern. The second wave of public concern is going to be, we don't like that. That's too much. There are going to be people who will not like what he's going to propose.
Correct.
And part of this, not just public relations, but part of, I think, our job as staff is to help you and the public understand why he says this has got to be there or that's got to be there. Then you can make a decision.
Exactly.
Like it or
yeah,
not.
I agree.
Well, one of the keys to this, too, is when you get through with this meeting with him between now and the 21st of February, there has to be a tremendous education process for us.
Correct.
A lot of give and take. We need to have a lot of meetings. We've got to know when we go in there that we know more than the public does so that we can intelligently deal with this issue.
Absolutely.
Okay? So believe me, I'm going to be all over it. And I want to make it, all the commission wants to be all over it.
We need to insist on that. That's when I'm talking about his team, there's more going on here than one person can do.
And you,
know, you get a feeling when a project gets real, takes on a life of its own.
Yep.
I'm waiting for that feeling.
Well, we're talking, you know, he's talking about, he's throwing the $150 to $200 million figures out there. That's $2 million a year going into the CRA for the city. Okay? So, along with talking about $500,000 worth of rent. So, we want to make sure that everyone understands all those things, this kind of investment. And that, because there's a lot of misconceptions out there, oh, the taxpayers are all paying for this and that. There's vertical construction here that's going to cover those costs, and this is going to be a catalyst for this downtown area. So.
Thank you.
Thanks, Doug.
Okay, questions? Yeah.
1400 Gulf Avenue, apartment number 4, Panama City. I appreciate being able to talk with you all about this. And I appreciate the fellow just before me brought up a lot of good points. I have 2 points to make at 10H and then one question after 10J. First of all, I appreciate y'all having the workshops for the people on the 21st. I would like to recommend that you have a specific format for that workshop that you could have maybe ready at your next meeting. I believe it's 2:14, is that correct? Your next?
Yes, yes.
Okay,
yes.
If you could have that ready to present to the public so that they'll know how to input into the 2:21st meeting, that would be helpful to facilitate public communication with the commission. So that's my recommendation. Yeah. Secondly,
I'm not sure we can do that, but
I'd like to bring up a red flag about this whole project. And I think it should be, this red flag would necessitate bring this whole thing to a screeching stop. This is Mr. Sonneblick's information. His transport feasibility is right here, it's all written out, that he wants to implement a bedroom tax for all lodging in Panama City Beach and Panama City for a trolley system and a water shuttle system taking tourists from Panama City Beach down front over to Captain Anderson's down beach and to the marina. It's all spelled out in here and back. So he's asking Panama City Beach people to pay money to him to bring Panama City Beach tourists to spend money in Panama City instead of Panama City Beach. And my question was, what are the Panama City Beach people going to say to this? They're paying money to have money taken out of their pocket, in other words. Now, I've talked and I've contacted Bay County Transit, because they're involved in this, because he's talking trolleys. I've called Bay Trolley, Bay Trolley, our trolley system, because it involves them also in their business. And I called the mayor's office at Panama City Beach, and then I talked to the Tourist Development Council, because Mr. Sonneblick would have to go through the Tournament Development Council to get his tax on the people in Panama City Beach to pay for his project in Panama City, which I think is absurd and upset and insane for him to do that. On a logistic level, it would take a year or two for him to present his proposal to the Tourist Development Council and have all those people talk about and decide if they want to be taxed for his project in Panama City. And I also talked to the mayor.
You're running over.
Okay, so I'm presenting that should be deeply thought about at this time before you proceed any further. Thank you.
Let me just clarify a couple of things real quick. First of all, I can't remember that report, but that was the beginning.
That was the
report.
First thing
he would say, yeah. He's not going to tax the people on Panama City Beach. Secondly, as you know, I'm the TPO chair. The trolley is not involved in this project currently, and unless he wants to provide some trolley system for downtown, then he'll have to work that in his own system, and that has to be an independent thing because the trolley system cannot do private enterprise unless they expand their services in terms of route. And everybody in the county would approve that, the county commission in every city as well, to provide those services. So that's not going to happen as well. So I think in his plan originally, he just talked about a water taxi, trolleys, that if there's a location on the beach that tourists want to come over here and ride a trolley. That was his dream in the beginning of how you get people over here so they don't have to drive. And there are certain buses that pick people up on the beach and drive them to certain areas. Then they do that currently now, and that's a private enterprise that does that. So,
and it was one of those things that during these discussions we said, you need to rethink this, and it just hasn't been reflected,
right,
updated.
Because there's been a lot of changes since that report comes out. So there's a lot of information, and I think as we move forward and the 21st comes, and I think a lot of that stuff will be tightened up.
Okay. The other thing, too, is you were referring to a bed tax. We already have a bed tax in place, so it has nothing to do with that.
I think it's safe to say I don't think you can create a tax unless the voters approve of it.
Right.
It has to be on a referendum.
Right. Yeah. Okay.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
Now, we've chose a staffing to come in and to negotiate for us on our behalf with Mr. Sonneblick. And right now, there have been quite a few changes that have been made throughout the whole concept. But now, one thing I would like to say, let's not lose confidence in our staffing because they are supposed to be the best we have. Now, they are supposed to bring something back to us. We are still at a go or no go. We still got that decision. So let's give our staff and the people that we chose to come and speak and negotiate for us, let's give them a chance. Let's wait until we get to the February the 21st before we really throw this thing out.
All right. Yes, sir. Name and address, sir?
Yes. Victor Vermillion, 433 Bunkers Cove Road, the Cove down the street. I've just briefly, obliquely been able to follow your discussions and so forth, but I'd just like to throw out one minor idea. This land just right next door to mm-hmm. our little marina park over there, our little kayak park over there, looks like it's come up for sale. And after you've gone through all these discussions, and if the marina project falls on its face or you got some other ideas to bring people down here, I'd just like to present that as maybe plan B, C, or D, that the city maybe obtain or take an option on that land and develop in a park for the citizens of Panama City. Living over here in the marina, there's one little small park, Adams Park, which allows me to go have access to the water. There's no parking, of course, so it's only for people who are within walking distance to get to that park. You have a beautiful Embarcadero or walkway along the beach drive there where people can walk and enjoy the water and so forth. But again, you have a little parking issue because you got to park in the residence. But there's no place here in Panama City where I, as a private individual, have access to the water. Down St. Andrews area, there's a small park that gives you small access. But this is a beautiful piece of land here that I think for the city would be a great investment for future generations and so forth. Now, you don't have to develop it, and it's going to cost a few bucks, I'm sure. But you don't have to develop it immediately, but it would provide access for people like myself to get their feet wet in this beautiful marina. Right now, I have to drive all the way to the Panama City Beach to go to the beach. Fortunately, I'm a retired military. I can go to Tyndall Air Force Base, but both of those places are relatively far away. This little plot of land down there, a couple, 3 acres, would be beautiful, and I'd like to put it as an idea for you folks to think about taking either an option on the land or just outright buying it.
I think it's safe to say that we've all tried that or thought of that, and we did attempt that once, didn't we,
yeah.
Mayor?
Yeah.
We did.
And
price was absurd. It's gotten to be ridiculous.
Wasn't it around $10 million?
It was $4 million.
Forgive me.
And
there were two property holders that really were not willing to sell at that time.
Weren't even willing to talk.
And a bank had part of it tied up. I don't know what.
Some we're always looking
so
at.
We agree with you.
We
agree.
We went through that.
I mean, we're good. It's a good thing we got the Elks Club property when we did because.
We do agree.
Okay.
But I will say about excess.
I'm new to the country.
That's right.
That's all right.
About the excess, or one of our items today was Snug Harbor Marina. And that's not going to be too far from you.
No, he's talking about walking, be able to park his car, walk on the beach.
Oh, you're not talking about getting in a boat.
A park where you can take your children down.
And you see the water. You mean, not
get
in a boat.
Get your feet in the water.
Not get in a boat. Okay.
Not a boat or anything like that. Just a park.
I get that.
Agreed, yeah.
$10 million, huh?
Well, no, four.
It was four for that piece, and then a couple million for the other. Yeah.
It was high, and there was commissions prior to us that talked about buying it.
So, sure. Well, food for thought, gentlemen.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else?
Infrastructure.
Okay.
Infrastructure sales tax.
Yeah, let's go on to 10J.
All right, so we need to structure an infrastructure surtax citizens committee. So if you remember back, so I just need some direction. So how many members? 5 to 7.
Five.
So five. And then the appointment process. So we have a choice. Either one, we can just have the city clerk take applications, or do you guys want to bring each a name?
I think, based on since this is affecting all our community, I think the application process would probably be, we could end up with a group of people in one area. I think each one of us should be able to pick somebody from our ward, the mayor could pick somebody at large, and that way it'll represent it'll represent the entire city at that point. So we'll get somebody from our wards to represent on the committee.
All right.
Jeff, what kind of demand on folks' time do you see this being? I mean, like a quarterly meeting or right around budget time? Or?
Well, and that was, my expectations are we would do these as soon as we finish a project. So, and we were talking about it, that I've met with staff and I'm trying to begin to develop a list. And so far we've probably got about 6 or 7 projects that we've easily identified of major projects that we can put on our list. These are not street resurfacing projects. Mm-hmm. These are major road work or water and sewer line improvements, primarily water line improvements that need to be done. So my expectations are that what we would do is we would do a project. And this would be the role of the committee, is my interpretation, is we would have the role of the committee be kind of like an audit role, so that once we got a project done, we would then take all of the paperwork and turn that paperwork over to them and say, here's all the financials of them, and this is all the money that was spent on this project, here's all the money that was spent, and you review it and sign off on it. Yes, we spent the money according to the law.
It's not beforehand.
No. That's what we would come to you guys with, is the projects. What I don't want to have happen is, well, we don't think that's a good project. When really, that's what we have staff.
Our responsibility.
And your guys' job is that we try to find, we go look for those projects.
Let me ask you this. Given that, though, Randall, why does it have to be somebody from each ward? Why wouldn't you want it? You really want it based, it doesn't matter if they all live in the same neighborhood, right, Mike? I mean, if it's a matter of having fiscal kind of sense and oversight response. It's not about, I don't see anything about the qualification that makes it specific to an area of the city, because they're not making recommendations for projects. They're just reviewing the soundness of what you've done, right?
Correct.
So.
But I think a good representation of our city, citywide, I think we could find somebody in all our areas, because every part of our city is going to have some issues, and again is, they could maybe give some recommendations. I don't know. I haven't seen the guidelines for it, but hopefully we're.
Will they be subject Mr. Stevens, you might have to answer, subject to sunshine.
Yes.
And Form 1s and all that kind of stuff.
Yep.
And financial disclosures. So.
Yep.
Well, here's the thing, too. If you have a representative for every district, they can get in there and you've got these six projects, and they say, they may bring up a project in the meeting that says...
Well, that's inconsistent with the role he's...
Well, no, I know, but I mean, they may bring something up that the next time that you have a meeting, go, listen, priority-wise, you think it's this, but maybe you should consider this, because that's why you're getting the input from these people. So, you understand? For the next time.
Well, yeah, we could. I mean, but you have to understand, the data that we have on roads and our water and sewer lines, we've got that information. And we know the condition of our roads. We know the average annual daily trips. We know when they were last paved. We know the condition they're in because we do it annually.
But the squeaky wheel gets the grease, too. So there's going to be sometimes you got one that's just as important as one as important as two, and you go, well, let's see which one's going to. So
I'd like to see the guidelines for the committee. I mean, it's kind of premature for us to decide how to structure it if we don't know what their role is. I mean, if I would like to maybe place further requirements on the membership. I mean, if you're talking about people making fiscal, they might need to have some. I'm concerned, Mike, about this kind of balkanization of the community that we see with our, like, repaving list. You know, we've had that discussion before where we're kind of divvying out repaving jobs based upon making each ward equal. And your ward may need more paving this year than my ward. So I think we need to look at it citywide. Certainly Kenny's ward suffers from a lot of it.
But I'm just, and I'm talking about the people to oversee what we do. It's staff's responsibility to find out where's number one at, and that's what we approve. They bring us the projects and says, here's number one, here's number two. That's what we approve. And from that, they do the project, and then this committee just oversees to make sure the infrastructure sales tax was spent on those infrastructure things.
Right.
It's the oversight of what we have done.
I don't mind a fresh set of eyes looking at anything.
Yes.
I think it's good.
Do you think they should have some additional requirements, like accounting background?
That's what we got to think about. You know, I mean,
You want to propose something to them?
I don't know that you'd have someone that has absolutely nothing to do with, any knowledge about construction or has lived here 2 or 3 months, and then all of a sudden they come in and say, or they do something that's not even connected with what we're talking about. We probably should have some type of...
The role I'm looking at, and the role that it would be just like the school board's review of the school tax. They do the exact same kind of role. Is after the expenditures are done, that board comes in and looks and makes sure that the money was spent according to how the statute says it was to be spent.
Mr. Jeff, this will be a citizens committee that will tell you something after the job has already been done?
They're there to review and to... let the citizens know that this money was spent. It is an outside citizens committee to ensure that the infrastructure surtax money was spent according to the statute.
Okay, but they don't make recommendations until...
No recommendations whatsoever. We didn't spend this money on anything other than the infrastructure improvements that we said we were going to spend it on, and that's the only thing that we spent it on.
It meets the guidelines of the statute.
Exactly.
Jeff,
okay,
will the funds be dispersed annually? Will they be allocated annually to us? We have X amount of dollars for this fiscal year, or estimated fiscal dollars. I mean, or do we get the dollars and then the projects? Am I making sense with that?
Yeah, so we will get these dollars. I believe they come in monthly, just like with our gas tax dollars. And so we will probably begin receiving them in March.
And then we'll have a feel for it after we have a few months.
Yeah.
We'll have a feel for
how
much.
So our expectations are, I think this year, I think we were, because it is a shortened year, we will probably get a little over $3 million.
Okay.
So we will probably not start projects until probably later on at the end of this year. And then in our budget going into next year, we will have a full slate of projects ready to go.
What you're saying is staff will be identifying the projects with this committee oversighting that?
No. We will already have these projects identified, brought to you.
Brought to us for approval.
Yes, just as part of the budget process.
They're like use auditors. They're not.
Exactly.
We
already have history, though, because the half cent, the school board gets a half cent. We know it's going to be somewhere right around $20 million a year. We have a track record of that already. But what we need to think about as a commission, too, is if there's a lot of projects that we need, that we know that we need, that there's an ability to borrow, to be able to say, hey, over the next 5 years, we know we want to complete this. Maybe we want to start this because we're going to have X amount of dollars coming.
Okay,
absolutely.
You can be flexible with that.
Yes,
okay,
absolutely.
I'm not sure.
So we need
but
to think
that committee
about
doesn't have anything to do with that.
Yeah, the committee doesn't have anything to do with that. But
are
we
required to have that committee?
That's what I'm really thinking
as
right
now. As part of it, everybody had said, yes, we would have. All the cities had said, yes, we would have.
Do we have to, this is a whole different issue, but are there any restrictions on carrying funds on this money? Like we have the CRA? I mean, not that it's going to be a problem. I'm sure we're going to spend it, but, you know, if...
I don't know for
sure. Say a project
sure.
gets delayed and you can't do it, and then do you have to... Because I know I know very little about the school board thing, but I know they're supposed to actually...
They have to commit.
They have to commit to these things, and then if something happens and you don't do it, how does that...
I don't know. I'd have
well,
to go
we'll
back
talk
and
about
look.
It, but...
Yeah.
Have to back
One more up. Question on this, after the fact. Now, if you have a list already, and the city's going to be operating with that list to fix streets, roads, whatever, pipes, lines. Now, if the priority list is already made up, and just like Mr. Cater was just saying, there is communities in our neighborhood that need it now and mm-hmm. have been needing it for some time.
Mm-hmm.
Now, do we get a priority list of where they will be placed? What is the criteria for choosing who get what when?
We are currently looking at that priority list right now. So we are looking at, in particular, water lines. Right now, we are looking at fire safety. Mm-hmm. So we are looking at lines right now that have fire hydrants on them, that are being served by smaller lines. Mm-hmm. So we're looking to upgrade those lines right now. So those would be our first priority.
Okay, water lines would be first priority. Then you'll go from there to the need, like, water line, next streets,
well,
for example,
right
just
now,
one or two.
Well, right now what we're looking at are water lines that are serving fire hydrants that are smaller than what they should be.
Okay.
Okay. So I'm looking at fire safety issues first.
Because
which will enhance the water for the community as well.
Which will, exactly. So the side effect is they'll have better water service.
But one thing for sure, it can only be used for infrastructure needs.
That's the
correct.
Only thing.
That's right.
It can't be used for anything else.
So... Then after that, so there's a list of those already that we're kind of working on. Then after that, then we're looking at some standard streets that are heavily traveled. So
because,
we've got some.
What I'm thinking about now, some time ago in the Millville area and also the Ward 2 Glenwood community area. Ward 2 is large, very, very large. It travels all over everywhere. But the most needed areas is the one we should address first. Now, that's going to come up on the priority list. And this committee will have a chance to address this to the, they will have no addresses.
No.
Well,
no.
You just come in after the fight and Correct. Say, tell us how you done.
Correct.
The committee, yeah.
They're
the
just
committee
oversight.
Tell us how
oversight.
You
they'll
done.
Come to the commission and get the list.
They'll make sure that it was spent
properly.
Properly.
Yep.
Okay.
That's it.
And it's up to our staff to figure out where those needs need to be addressed first, and what priorities,
because,
like we talk about water pressure.
Now, what I'm looking at is, in order to choose someone that's going to fit that category and come in and do that, they're going to have to be somewhat of an expert, not expert, just someone with knowledge. So when we choose someone, it's got to be a knowledgeable person of everything that we're addressing and going to.
And it's a double-edged thing, because it's got to be somebody mm-hmm. knowledgeable, but some of the people that are most knowledgeable about that, maybe bidding on these jobs, so they can't be part of that
group. Yeah,
because they'd have to recuse themselves, right?
Yeah, you
right?
can't have
that's right. Can't
so
have
you,
that.
So you yeah. got that's a real paradox. I mean, because those are folks that know the most about these projects, you know, contractors and stuff that work on them.
Or old retired.
Well,
ones.
So what we're trying
old
to do,
retired
well, basically,
ones.
Let's get
right,
let's
if
get
you,
to
if
the
you
room.
Just or business people in general, or somebody that can look at it and say, or that looks at it and says, Okay, you bid a project, you know, here's the list of expenditures. Yeah, so we get an accounting of from there. Mm-hmm. Here's where we said we spent all the money, and here's where we spent all the money.
Well, can you prepare some requirements for us that you think, and,
sure.
and maybe a description of the panel? And
sure.
I think what he said today was, yep. how many members do we want on the committee?
Yep.
You know, the process, the process,
right. we don't need
the process of doing it, and
okay.
and the length of
then the length of the time. So, do you want them 2 years? Do you want them 3 years? Remember, this is a 10-year cycle we're looking at. So,
let's say 3 years.
Okay.
And with rotating. Like
so we need to rotate
time.
Them. So
five
do you want
people.
To do
rotate them
five.
Very much similar to what we.
So do you
want to
do 2-2-1 or do you want to do a 3-2?
Either one.
Okay. I don't know. I think we're gonna have trouble getting people to serve on it.
All right.
We'll see. All right. We'll see. But you know,
all right,
so
now,
I think that's
got a
thankless
right.
job.
We may have to just have one member or something.
Okay.
Thank you. I got my walking.
Yes.
I haven't moved. I'm in the same resident as I was when I came up here last time. Just one question in regards to the infrastructure. Is this committee going to be making the decision for the city spending money on the infrastructure for the marina project?
No.
No.
Thank
yeah.
you.
Yeah.
Have a nice day. Appreciate the input.
I think Mr. Henry's volunteering for the committee.
I'm volunteering Mr. Henry for the committee.
He heard retired utility guy, and he's up here. Look at him.
I was back there looking for the blue shirt. No pun intended.
You all are going to have some long meetings, I'm just telling you.
614 Maple Avenue, Panama City, Florida, 3241. I'm in the Millville area, but I'm part of the Cove, really. I was just listening, and I know y'all saying that, city manager saying that they go set up how where this thing, the money is going to be spent, what streets they're going to be repaired, what water lines is going to be replaced. And I think that, I know, as we are as commissioners, mayors, I think every commissioner ought to have a part in this. They should see the plan that he's setting up. They should check their own streets. They depend on what street need to be repaired first. They need to plan on what water lines need to be replaced first. I think they need to call their peoples together. And folks know in their neighborhoods, they know their problems. They know the condition of their problem, what happened in their water system, even in their sewers. If we're going to replace a street, why are we going to replace it? Go down the road, look at a street. They got a pothole in it. That pothole is there because there's a problem. Hmm. And you go take good money and put over a pothole. Pothole probably won't last you another year. Then the pothole is right back there again. Now. Committee's not going to have anything to say, just saying where you spent the money. Why you need a committee to say where you spent the money? Commissioner can say that where you contribute right. that where you spent the money. A committee don't need to say that if he ain't got no say so. If you look at that plan, look at the plan that you have, and that plan that person know that money's need to be spent in a worse position than what y'all planned on it being put on. So it's not hipping that much. What you're telling us, you know more than we know. I know we will put you on the board, we'll set you in place, but I think it come a time that people should be heard. And
okay.
when it come the time that you're paying or doing something in their neighborhood, on their streets, what need to be done, what need to be fixed, I think they should be heard about it.
I think, Mr. Henry, you know, we're given a list of all these different streets that ahead of time, okay? And we'll be given a list of all those things. And in our commission meetings, you know, there's a report, and we look at it, and at that particular time, when you're here, and you'll get the list, then you can come up before we ever start that project and say, you know something? I see you guys have got so-and-so and so-and-so. Well, when I used to work here 15 years ago, and I remember on the next street over, if we did this first, it would make this better. And I appreciate your input. Yeah. And so, and I want you to keep coming. So that opportunity will be afforded.
Well said,
and,
Mayor.
And I think,
no doubt.
And I think you said something about potholes. I think the goal of this infrastructure sales surtax is to work on those water lines first. I think that's probably priority number one, to start getting some of the dirty water cleared up, fixing those first, because when we had the old pipes and we put a new road down, pipes bust, boom, now we got more potholes, we're tearing up the new road. So I think it's going to be the underground getting the new water, and quite frankly, I don't care where we start at, as long as we start a project and we start clearing up all those pipes and put clean waters in people's houses so they could take baths and not brown waters come in any neighborhood. I don't care where it starts at. And then two from that is, once we get done with that, then you can come back and do the roads. And also, is the city's not going to abandon the money they allocate every year for street projects and other projects that we have in the budget already. So this is additional infrastructure money that we're going to start improving the infrastructure of our city that's desperately needed. And I think it's going to be underground first.
That's well and good, I understand. I think somebody else needs to have input more than it could, city manager. And out and that saying what need to be done.
But I think the citizens call Mr. Henry, I think citizens call Mr. Yeah. Stanley all the time and say, hey, I got brown water over here, man, you gotta come fix it, and I think they go out and so I think the citizens do give input, and they've identified those projects. And he'd probably give you a list of $30, $40 million projects we probably have to do today on the infrastructure. So the citizens do reach out and tell them, and they've come to this podium and showed us pictures of stuff that's coming out of their water, or their tubs, or whatever it may be. So I think this
and it's changed our priorities.
Well, yes, yeah. And I think this is a good thing to start.
Well, I'm looking to see one of your plans. See where you plan on doing this work, where you plan on laying this, putting it, these repairs on.
Sure.
And I think that some of the stuff that if need to have been done a long, long time ago.
Yep.
You ain't got a problem with what you're talking about doing. It's fine. I'm talking about the input part of it. Mm-hmm. Just you got one person putting all the input, or two people putting all the input, I think need more than that. So if you're going to put somebody on something, let them have some say-so about it. If it's not going to do any good, I think you need to hear.
Thank you, Mr. Henry.
Appreciate you. Anyone else? Okay. I think that 10.
Break, maybe?
We need a break.
And just real quick, I think... I don't know if Mr. Stanley could confirm this or not, or Mr. Fravel, or whoever, but I think when we identify those projects, we list them on our website as well, on what projects we've identified as our priorities to work on as well. And we'll continue to do that as we move forward.
Yes. One last thing. Don't we normally spend around 2.7 a year on infrastructure projects? Is that what the budget is? Somewhere between 2.5 and 3?
That's all capital improvements.
Okay. And so now we're talking about just about, even for this year, it's going to even be more. So we're going to expedite different things that we know that we have to do in the next, instead of doing it in 5 years, we'll be able to do it in 3. You know what I mean? So we know what the list is, but we just need to make sure we prioritize it. Yeah. Okay. Anyone? Anything else? We'll be back for our CDC meeting in a few minutes. Thank you.